So now let's return to where we started and learn more about how UCSF is integrating the power and potential of AI into science and healthcare. I've invited three experts to join me on the stage, and I welcome them up now. I'm delighted to introduce Atul Butte, who is the Priscilla Chan and Mark Zuckerberg Distinguished Professor. He is also director of the Baker Computational Health Sciences Institute and is the chief data scientist for all of UC Health, the six academic health centers in the UC system. Joining me is also Sarah Murray, who is Associate Professor of Medicine and Chief Health AI Officer. And finally, Dr. Tanya Kotemi, who is a Professor of Bioengineering and Therapeutic Sciences. So thank you for joining me on the stage, and let's get started. I'm going to ask a few general questions and ask each of you to comment. Maybe Atul, I'll ask you to kick this one off, but how well do you think UCSF is prepared and ready to take advantage of this particular moment in time?
Well, Sam, thanks for having us and having me on the panel in front of this amazing audience. Obviously, I think UCSF is amazingly positioned to take advantage of this new revolution on top of revolutions. Obviously, we're in an amazing time, we're in an amazing place with amazing neighbors in Silicon Valley, but as your video showed, we have amazing talent at UCSF, and we have to always start with that. Now, the Baker Computational Health Sciences Institute, partnering with IT Services, Radiology and Imaging Sciences, the Cancer Center, the Clinical Translational Science Award, have been building the Information Commons, which takes data out of our clinical systems, de-identifies it, and makes it available for research and development safely, responsibly. That is incredibly important because it includes images and clinical text as well, which is the current revolution with large language models. So we use all that for safe and responsible research, but we've also been leading UC Health with our five sibling health systems, UCLA, UC San Diego, Irvine, Davis, and Riverside, to pull together a central database of more than 9 million patients treated over the past decade. That all is available for research and development. What this means is it's safely, responsibly, and respectfully using the most inclusive and diverse data set, I believe, in the country to help us build inclusive tools that help us treat the diversity of California and beyond. I think we're incredibly positioned to make a lot of advances over the next few years.
On the health system side, we've put into place a few pieces of key infrastructure that I also think are positioning us very nicely to lead. One of those is our health IT platform for advanced computing. We call it HIPAC. And it allows us to take real-time electronic health record or EHR data, run any AI model type, and then write those predictions back into our EHR. And so we're actually already using that for a number of use cases in the health system, supporting our command center, where we're getting the right care to the right patient at the right time. And then we've opened up access to that to our research community as well through the APEX-enabled research group. And so we have researchers bringing tools that, you know, predict toxicity in oncology patients and implementing those in the health system as well. Then more recently, in June of this year, our IT leadership worked to put together an AI tiger team and build infrastructure to support generative AI, which was mentioned. Out of that came a tool called Versa, and there are two big components to that. One is Versa Chat, which allows us to actually, it's very ChatGPT-like, but you can use it securely. It's HIPAA compliant with our patient data, so we can really start testing those clinical use cases that we're very excited about. And then there's something called an API version of that as well, which allows our researchers to use it with large data sets and allows us to take those large language models and generative AI tools and bring them into the health system as well. So there's many exciting use cases that we're looking forward to.
What about in the basic sciences, Tanya? How prepared are we?
Yeah, so in the discovery sciences, AI is already an integral part of acceleration and advances across the multiple scales, all the way from the atomic to the molecular, to the cellular and tissue scale, and then ultimately, obviously, with a view to improve human health. And so I can just perhaps give a couple of examples. On the molecular scale, we've heard about AlphaFold 2, an AI model that enabled incredible advances in predicting the structure of proteins from sequence with unprecedented accuracy. So now at UCSF, we are pioneering advances that go beyond AlphaFold, that not only predict the structures of existing proteins, but instead are able to create new proteins completely from scratch. And so now these proteins have multiple applications, for example, as precision tools enabling fundamental biological discovery, but also in the therapeutic space to allow us to enable development of protein drugs that are programmable and much more powerful, more specific, and then can be much more rapidly developed than traditional protein tools and protein drugs. And then as another example, to highlight how AI integrates advances across the multiple scales, it directly accelerates drug discovery by, for example, enabling target discovery by integrating large-scale data sets from the molecular to the cellular to the tissue scales to really enable us to see what the most powerful targets are that we need to address in drug discovery efforts.
Great, thank you. Now I'd like to ask each of you to briefly give me a prediction of what you think we'll see at UCSF in the next 12 to 24 months.
Yeah, maybe I can start here. So UCSF, to my mind, has a number of key ingredients that I think uniquely position us to take advantage of the amazing advances in AI. And so I think the first one is a long-standing history of technology development. So large-scale data, as we heard from Sam, are absolutely essential to drive advances in AI. And we at UCSF have been always at the forefront of developing technologies that generate those data at scale. Secondly, what is important is that these data are not just generated at scale, but they need to be informative in terms of important and key biological problems. And I think we at UCSF have the researchers who have consistently pioneered the most interesting and the most challenging questions in biology that will inform what are the data that we need to generate to make advances. And then thirdly, I think we have a unique culture of collaboration, where collaboration is a value in the sense that the students, the postdocs, the faculty, and staff are coming together from different disciplines to tackle incredibly hard problems and make advances there, where no individual research group could make these advances on their own. And so what I would like to see over the next year or two is to have experts in AI development and application to be embedded in this unique culture of collaboration, exciting key biological questions, and technology development to pioneer advances at UCSF that I think could be unique to what we can do here.
So in the health system, we want to be the leading health system for the use of trustworthy AI at scale to address the most pressing problems in healthcare. So what does that mean practically? Well, trustworthy AI means that we have the processes in place to make sure that our tools are ethical, robust, fair, safe, and we're evaluating that both when we're doing our initial implementations and then longitudinally as we use the tools. And then AI at scale is really important because most of the AI implementations we've seen across the country have been relatively small. We want to be using these tools enterprise-wide. And so a lot of our initial focus is going to be on use cases that have very high impact, but lower risk as we learn to use these tools safely. And so something we're thinking a lot about is this concept that's been coined, keyboard liberation, really getting clinicians away from their computers and back in front of patients where they want to be. And so we have a number of use cases we're looking at right now. We're hoping AI Scribes is deployed widely in the next 12 to 24 months. And in fact, our faculty practice office is leading the first pilot of 100 users with a tool called Ambiance in the coming weeks to start looking at these AI scribing tools. And then we're very excited. We now have access to a suite of tools from Epic that's going to allow us to test many of these generative AI use cases. And so those will be use cases that involve message drafting, chart summarization, a lot of these day-to-day tasks clinicians spend a lot of time with. And so we're really excited about those.
I think it's fair to say UCSF has always been in the business of building tools that don't exist today. I think we saw that in some of the videos, and that's going to be no different for artificial intelligence. We're going to see more predictive models, predictive tools, especially using text and images. Those have been always the hardest to get to with computers and AI. We're going to get a text summarization, understanding perhaps 1,000 or 10,000 patients, where are we missing care? What should we be delivering more care to in entire populations? Matching with clinical trials in an automated way that we might be missing opportunities to deliver potential life-saving drugs because we're not thinking that a patient might qualify for a clinical trial. Even understanding our patients better. Why did this patient stop taking this medication? Is it because of a side effect or a socioeconomic challenge that they're facing? All of this might be better understandable through artificial intelligence, looking at our clinical notes. Now, to do all this, we're going to need more infrastructure. So I predict we're going to see more data centers and compute clusters accessible by UCSF faculty, staff, students, researchers, but also more partnerships with companies that surround us, some of the best talent in the world in computers and data. But I also see us generating more companies too. We've always been in the business that we don't just keep our discoveries within our walls. Part of that is scaling to reach more patients, more families, and we can't scale by just keeping things and facing inward. Part of our business is really to scale to patients everywhere. And I can see us starting new companies as well, like our faculty have great abilities to do.
Great. So the last question, a few minutes just on touching on what we're doing to make sure that our use of AI is responsible, it's ethical, and it meets our values of social justice. Sarah, particularly in the health system, this is important, so perhaps you could start.
Sure. So about a year ago, we launched our AI Oversight Committee to guide the health system in the use of trustworthy AI. And so the idea here is that we actually have a unified governance committee for all AI that touches the health system. It doesn't matter if my team builds it in the health system, if we procure it from a vendor, or if a researcher is building it and wants to implement it in the health system. We want to be asking the same questions, ensuring we have performance metrics and fairness metrics, and we're being really thoughtful about the implementation of all of these tools. Our committee has representatives across the campus in the spirit of that unified governance, and so there's health system leaders, ethicists, biostatisticians, health equity experts, and we're all coming together to really build these processes. If you're interested in some of the details, you can actually look on ai.ucsf.edu if you're internal, but I'd say it's still a work in progress. We're working on figuring out how we scale the committee's work to accommodate the growing needs, and then expand these ethical frameworks to more challenging tools we're starting to think about, like the generative AI tools.
And maybe I'll answer from the research side. Obviously, there's concern about using data sets that might not have been acquired in a diverse or fair manner. Why I'm so proud of being at UCSF and the University of California is that the diversity of the world comes to California and lives in California and is treated by the University of California. And so the data we have, I think, is going to be, it's not perfect, I admit that, but I think it's going to cover more of the diversity of California and thus the world, perhaps more than our peer institutions in other well-known cities. I think it's our responsibility and duty to use that data to generate these tools now for the future.
And Tanya, I know you've been in conversations at the national level around the ethical use of AI in discovery sciences.
Yeah, so if we say that generative AI can design incredibly powerful and programmable medicines, of course, then the question that we need to think about is, can that be turned around for dual use? and make dangerous biological agents. And so while our understanding of biology to be able to do this, even with the most powerful AI tools, is not at the level where we can do this today, I would say today is the time to really think about those aspects. And this is something that cannot be restricted to UCSF. It cannot be restricted to just a national level. It also has to be an effort at the international level. And so there are discussions that UCSF leaders are being part of that bring together industry stakeholders, as well as scientific experts, as well as security experts, and policymakers and security experts, including in the White House Office of Science and Technology, together to really think about and coming together what the defining principles are to make the development as well as dissemination of AI technology responsible.
Well, please join me in thanking our panelists for sharing their thoughts.